because it's my job to introduce inaugural lectures, which are a really nice tradition within the university community, an opportunity to celebrate career success, and they're always really enjoyable and good fun. I was just talking to John, we haven't had an inaugural in computer science for quite a few years. Lots of other schools have them more regularly, so there'll be a few people in the audience sweating during this, knowing that they're going to have to do their inaugural soon. I'm sure everyone will enjoy it very much, and I'll be here at the end to do a summing up. So,
okay.
Over to you.
Thank you very much, Kevin. There's this light on. Switch off this. Okay, yeah, so thank you for coming. There are lots of people here. Welcome. I mean, where to start? There are some colleagues I haven't seen for a while from further afield. There are colleagues, I mean, yeah, from Birmingham, from Cambridge, Leicester. I'm sure I forgot something important. What did I forget? What?
Bristol.
Bristol. Who is from Bristol? Okay. Oh, there. Okay. Great. Bristol. What else? Come on. Yeah, keep me up. There are colleagues from computer science. Anybody from computer science here? Oh, yeah, there. Okay. Oh, yeah, are there some students here? Yeah, real students. I know you are not a real student. I mean PhD students. Yeah, but are there some people from my Python class here? There, yeah, some. Okay, good. What else? I don't know. Mathematicians. Yes, yeah, some mathematicians. Real ones. Okay, yeah, there. Good. Thank you for coming. Good. So what am I going to talk about? So this picture here is the title page of my book. You can even buy it at some point in the future once it's published. Yeah, once it's written. Okay, it's not finished. I mean, it's one of these books, you know. I'm rewriting it. It's getting better and better. I hope so. The Tao of Types. Yeah. So what is it about and what is my talk about? So this cartoon was put on my door by one of my colleagues, and I have a suspicion who was it. Yeah, and it's a summary of this talk, actually. I think the line below was sort of changed, but it says, I mean, this cowboy obviously has shot this. Okay, I mean, he's disappeared. And then he says, "You guys are both my witnesses." He insinuated that ZFC set theory is superior to type theory. Okay, be careful. Okay, but I'm not really so violent. I don't know why this was used. Oh yeah, here's something. Actually, what I wanted to say is I don't usually use slides. I really hate slides. I mean, these things. Yeah. I hate them, yeah? Because first, you spend a lot of time preparing them, and then you put them up and you think, this is not really what I want to say now, because now I have a much better idea what to say, yeah? And you spend ages to prepare them, so it's really, really annoying. So I really prefer giving talks on the whiteboard, I mean, if it's something sort of mathematical, or if it's something more computer science-y, I do it live coding, it's called. It's very exciting because it usually goes wrong. But this adds to the entertainment value of the lecture, I think. It's true. Things go wrong is maybe better than things always going right. And you can actually mix it because now we have these computer proof systems. I mean, computer-based proof systems, which are related to my talk. And you can do live coding with them. However, Graham recommended me not to do a whiteboard talk, and I after thinking about what I want to say, I realized that that's a good idea because it would otherwise take 4 hours, right? So now I have slides, it will only take 2 hours. Lock the doors, yeah? Otherwise people may get away. Okay, so what is my talk about? I thought maybe the best way to present to give a talk which is also accessible. Hi, good to see you. I wanted to give an accessible talk, which is maybe interesting for everybody, for the students, also for people who are not actually from computer science. So I thought I'd talk about history. And I should remark, when I talk about history, the emphasis on story. Yeah, I find important that there is a good story. It's not so historical correctness is not really so important. Yeah, and also it's a his story. I have to admit, because all the people involved are male. But I mean that's a shame. I mean I'd like to. Hopefully, it will change in the future. So history. Let me talk about history. What's history? History, let's start with sets, okay? Sets. So this gentleman here, Georg Cantor, is usually blamed for inventing sets. He calls them Mengen because he is German. What did he do? Oh, yes, he gives this sort of definition. I mean, it's an intuitive idea of what a set is. By a set, mit einer Menge, okay, I stopped the German. By a set, we are to understand any collection into a whole of definite and separate objects of our intuition and our thought. That's clear, isn't it? Anything goes, right? Cool, right? Yeah, what did he do? I mean, okay, let me give you some examples of sets. So he also invented these curly brackets. So you use curly brackets to write sets. And if you write nothing in this, then you have the empty set. That's one set. Because if you can't think of anything, you use the empty set, right? And then a very famous set is the set of natural numbers, which in computer science starts with zero. We start counting at zero, okay? If that's for you, okay. So 0, 1, 2, the counting numbers, yeah? And, okay, as soon as you open a bank account, you become aware of the existence of negative numbers. This is my experience, at least. So you get the integers, which include the negative numbers. But there's more. There are the real numbers, the so-called real numbers. I don't know whether that's a good name. And I didn't really want to write any curly brackets because there are far too many of them. I have to get rid of this head thing. So pi, for example, is the relation between the diameter and the circumference of a circle. It's 3.1415926, and then goes on, and it never repeats itself. It goes on forever. But we can have other sets. For example, the set of the previous examples. Yeah, because you can put sets in sets. It's a set of sets, right? Well, that's fine. It's a set which has 4 elements, the empty sets, the natural numbers, the integers, and the reals, which are sets themselves. And we can also have weird sets, like the set of the number 3 and the reals. And we can have the set of all sets. Yeah? I mean, something we can think of is a set of all sets. And the set of all sets obviously contains itself because it's a set, right? So so we write V element V means V is an element of the set V. I didn't really dare to start even writing the set. It's so huge, you know. It's really hard to imagine. Okay. What's next? Oh, yes. So Cantor, although he didn't just invent sets, but a mathematician, he proved something about them. And the first thing, one of the things he looked at is cardinality, which means counting the elements in a set. To answer the question, when do two sets have the same number of elements? And the method he used was the method of the shepherds who couldn't count. Yeah, you have two shepherds, and they claim they have the same number of sheep, but they can't count. So how can they find out that they have the same number of sheep? So they have this double gate, and they get the sheep one by one through this gate, and if they match exactly, if all the sheep are through in there and nothing is left, then obviously they have the same number of sheep. Ingenious, right? So this way, they could avoid counting them. And we can do the same thing with infinite sets. So for example, the natural numbers and the integers, we can drive through this double gate in this way, 0 and 0 and 1 and minus 1 and 2 and 1 and 3 and minus 2 and 4 and 2 and so on. Yeah, I hope you get the idea. So this way we can show that actually the integers and the natural numbers have the same number of elements. Yeah. And Cantor, he showed more. He showed that there is no such assignment between the natural numbers and the real numbers. And basically, the reason is that there are just too many more real numbers than there are natural numbers, that they're even both of, you could think both are infinite, but actually, he could show that there is no assignment between the natural numbers and the real numbers, no one-to-one assignment. So hence, that shows us that there are more real numbers than natural numbers. Okay, here is another thing which I wanted to mention about Cantor proved about sets. So if you look at the natural numbers, you have this sort of order, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And it's this less than order. And if you think about it, this sort of relation, the less than relation on the natural numbers, has two properties. If you have any two numbers, they are related one way or the other. If you have two different numbers, they're related one way or the other, and it's transitive. From 1 is less than 2 and 2 is less than 3, you also know that 1 is less than 3. And the third property is if you start with any number and you go down, you will have to stop after a finite number of steps. Yeah? If you start with 5, you can go down to 3, 2, 1, but until you end up at 0, you have to stop. And this is called well order. And Cantor, he proved that not just the natural numbers can be well ordered, but every set can be well ordered. And that was a very clever proof. If you think about it, it's not so easy because if you start with 0.1, even if you just look at the positive reals, you can go closer and closer to zero and never have to stop. So it's a bit more tricky to come up with a well ordering for the reals. It's not so clear. Yeah? But Cantor was very clever and proved this, but this was not completely appreciated. There was some guy called Kronecker who said, "I don't know what predominates in Cantor's theory, philosophy or theology, but I'm sure that there's no mathematics there." Yeah. So actually, if you tell a mathematician that there's some philosophy involved, they run away. This is like a swear word in mathematics. Yeah? And basically, they said, "Oh, this is all bullshit, what you're doing," Kronecker said. Okay, let's move on with my history, which I'm sorry mathematicians know very well, so they know what comes next, right? Any mathematics comes next? What? Gödel? Okay, I didn't include Gödel. Oh, that was a good idea. No, I'm sorry, him. Yeah. Frege, Gottlob Frege, another German. You see, I have some certain relationship to Germans here. But I thought I also introduce an Englishman, Bertrand Russell, a typical image of pipe Englishman, right? Okay. So what do these two gentlemen have to do with each other? So Frege, maybe he was concerned about all this criticism for Cantor. He thought, we really have to fix the basic rules of mathematics. And he wrote a book called Begriffsschrift in German. I don't know how to translate this. It's a book about notions. It's a very basic book. And one thing he did is he developed what we call predicate logic. And this is something you can use to torture undergraduate students, as maybe some of my colleagues know. Yeah. So here's my favorite tautology in predicate logic. In every non-empty pub, there is one person. If this person drinks, then everybody drinks. And the maybe slightly surprising thing is that this is actually a tautology. I mean, what does it mean? I have written it down here in predicate logic. But, I mean, there's this funny symbol. This means exist, and this means for all. But actually, this statement has nothing to do with drinking and with pubs. It's true whatever you plug in. So it's a tautology. And that's maybe surprising. But you can do some experiments and visit some pubs to find out whether this is true. I mean, empirically. I mean, maybe a little exercise for people who are not mathematicians to think why this is always true. Yeah? It seems to be first counterintuitive, but it turns out it's always true. So it's a tautology. But Frege, he also, he wanted to basically for all of mathematics, in particular, he also included sets inspired by Cantor. But there was a little problem, and actually Russell wrote a letter to Frege, in German, by the way, you can find it on the internet, so you would in German. And he was very polite, and he basically also asked, he was basically a fanboy of Frege. He said, I really want to have some of your papers, can you send them to me? But by the way, I think there's a little problem. You say you can form any sets. So what about the set of all sets which do not contain themselves? The set of all sets which do not contain themselves. And why is this a problem? Because if this set contains itself, it should not contain itself, right? Because it contains all the sets which do not contain themselves. But if it doesn't contain itself, it should contain itself, because it doesn't contain itself. And that's bad news. That means, this is called the Russell paradox. And he basically, he killed Frege's theory. And Frege was, I mean, he was a little bit depressed, actually. Yeah. He wrote a footnote to his book to say, everything in this book is actually wrong. He had printed already, so it was too late. So, yeah. That was a bit, I mean, of a sad story, right? So I have been teaching this myself, and my colleague, Connor, who's very good in drawing cartoons, draw a version of this paradox, which is also famous, because instead of sets, you can use a barber. And this barber shaves everybody in the village who does not shave himself. And that's the same problem, right? What does he do? He's standing in front of this mirror and like, should I shave myself? No, I only shave the people who don't shave themselves. I don't shave myself. Oh, I have to shave myself. So it's no surprise that this barber becomes a bit violent and kills his customers, right? So that's a true story of Sweeney Todd, right? Okay, so let's move on. Axioms. Yeah, we need axioms. Come, give us axioms. And then now we have two more gentlemen, and they are so featured in this cartoon. You know, ZF, Zermelo and Frankel. Both also German. Frankel, luckily before things got nasty, he moved to Israel. He's a Jew, or was a Jew. Whereas Frankel, Zermelo was a German. He stayed in Germany, but he also got in trouble. He refused to give the Hitler gruß in the beginning of the lecture, and he got a little bit in trouble, but he didn't get seriously in trouble. So Zermelo started it. Zermelo, he wanted to fix, basically, what Frege wasn't able to do, and he used, actually, some ideas of Frege, in particular, used predicate logic. But he formulated some axioms, some basic facts about sets. And I show them to you, but I'm not going to explain them in detail. So this is a modern version of the axioms of set theory. I just want to show them to see it's not too big, but it's not very small either, something in between. And what he did is, he gave some axioms which allow us to construct sets, and the sets which mathematicians need most of the time, but not the nasty ones. Yeah? So not the set of all sets which does not contain themselves, and also not the set of all sets. These are not sets in Zermelo's theory. And one interesting feature of Zermelo's theory was that he actually didn't need anything else but sets. So in particular, he didn't need numbers. It's he just needed sets, and we see there are no Ur elements, and no nothing else, only sets. That was really clever. If you look at this, I'm not a big fan of set theory, but yeah, something cool about this. Frankel sort of revised it, but he also added an important axiom. It's called replacement. It's down here somewhere. By the way, I don't want to explain them in detail, but if you look how they work, for example, there is an axiom of pairing. It says if you have two sets, you can form a new set which just contains these two elements. So it just gives you ways to construct sets. Another axiom which is quite famous is the axiom of choice. is down here. It's a bit longer than the others. And which is needed to prove this this well ordering theorem by Cantor. And actually, people then showed it's actually equivalent. So you could either assume the well ordering theorem and then can derive choice, or you derive choice and you can derive well ordering. So these two principles are equivalent. And mathematicians usually they admit when they use choice. You know, they're a little bit embarrassed about it. No, you're not embarrassed about it. Some mathematicians are embarrassed about it. Others are not, as I just found out. Are you embarrassed about it? What?
I have a clue about
it. You have the clue. You do it everywhere. Okay. It's just morning before you have breakfast, you use choice three times. I know, because that's cool. I mean, some are embarrassed, but okay. Others are cool about it. Fair enough. I wanted to say a little bit, this is actually quite useful. So how are the numbers actually defined in set theory? So for Neumann, who's also famous in computer science, he gives the following definition. So zero is just the empty set. And one is the set containing zero, which if you expand it is this set. And two is the set containing zero and one, and so on. And you see all these curly brackets. This is actually a problem. If you write this on the whiteboard, it looks like some worms sort of moving over the whiteboard. I find it very difficult to draw these properly. But Zermelo's original definition is actually slightly different. He just constructs a set containing the previous number. So one is the set containing zero, and two is the set containing one. And if you look at the numbers, you basically just count the curly brackets to find out what number it is. And the axiom of infinity, that was one of the axioms, states that the natural numbers form a set. So it's like you said, axiom of pairing. There are some axioms how you can form sets. And if you want to have an infinite set, you don't get it for free. You have to do something. You have to put an axiom. And the axiom says, okay, this is a set. And actually, there's a bit of a problem. If you use one definition, like for example for Neumann's, then how do you show that Zermelo is a set? And that's exactly where you need this extra axiom, which is called replacement by Zermelo. No, by Frankl. By Frankl, right. And here's one thing I remark. These two definitions of the numbers, we can distinguish, we can observe that they are different by saying, so this sign here means subset, means all the elements in one are also in two. And this is true for Neumann, because one has only one element, zero, which is also in two. But this is not true for Zermelo, because one has here also one element, zero, but that's not in two. And all I'm pointing out is that we can observe, we can talk about properties of the numbers, which has nothing to do with them being numbers. Yeah? And any well-educated mathematician will never do this. Right? This is a stupid proposition. Yeah? But you can. And that's a problem, as you will see. Okay. What comes actually next in my slides? Ah! Yeah. So now think, you may be expecting that types are coming, but not yet. Yeah? I'm sorry if I disappoint you. Not yet. Yeah? In the moment, I want to talk about intuition. Yeah? And these two gentlemen come up. This is Lutzen Brauer, a Dutchman, and David Hilbert. Yeah, David. Okay. Hilbert, very famous, one of the greatest mathematicians ever. And I actually want to talk more about Brauer, but I thought I'd put Hilbert in as well. Actually, they had a bit of an argument. Let me get there. Brauer? Brauer, I think, was a bit of a difficult character, to be honest. He said that many he was a mathematician. He did some interesting work in topology, but then he became very sort of awkward and said there are mathematical proofs which are not really justified by intuitively valid reasoning. And some people say, yeah, all of them. Okay. That's the point. He was in particular, he thought there are some principles, some actually very basic logical rules are a bit fishy. And so one he pointed out is what's called the principle of the excluded middle, or tertium non dato, as we Latin people say, which says that every proposition, a proposition is just a statement, is either true or false. And that sounds pretty harmless, right? That makes perfect sense, right? And in the formalism of logic, we write P or not P, to be or not to be, which is a bit strange, actually, because why asking this question if it's a tautology? Anyway, why is there a problem? I can give you my own view on this, which is philosophical, though it's a non-starter for mathematicians, obviously, which is like this. So if you think about facts about the real world, then it doesn't really matter whether you know them. They're either true or false. Yeah, I mean, if I say a cat in a box, then people think of the wrong thing. Okay, if there's something here written and I don't see it, I don't know it, it's still true or false if I make any statement about it, right? Even if I don't know it. So every statement about the real world and our understanding of the real world is true or false, even if we don't know it. But here we're talking about not the real world, but we're talking about, as Cantor said, objects of our intuition, our thought. And it's not so clear whether they behave the same way as things in the real world. Because what are really sets? Are they really there? Are they real? That's maybe a bit problematic. So there's this called Platonism. So Plato was a Greek philosopher, and he said that the world of ideas is actually even more real than the world we see. And the world we see is just a reflection of the world of ideas. That's complete bullshit, I think, but okay. So that's a way to explain Brouwer's unhappiness. And he had a big argument, a famous argument with Hilbert, who said, you cannot just get rid of this, and all our all our proofs will disappear. Yeah, I mean, all our theorems fall down. Yeah, and I think he wasn't actually right. But anyway, you just have to be a bit more precise. But okay, so that was his criticism. But one thing which people didn't talk about at this time, but which is important for us nowadays, especially in computer science, is that unlike the logic which we call classical logic, logic with excluded middle, the logic without is constructive. That means whenever we construct something, if we show there exists something, then we can also compute it. Yeah? And this is an important relation with computer science, because lots of things we talk about in computer science, they have a very natural expression in intuitionistic logic, and they don't fit so well together with classical logic. So, by the way, sidelines, this excluded middle is actually not so bad, because we can get rid of it by translating something. So it's like there's this little barbel fish. So if an intuitionist talks to a classical mathematician, like you, if you say P or Q, and the barberfish seems, he means it cannot be that they are both false, right? And if you say they exist,
that's the same.
Yeah, it's the same for you, but not for me, yeah. And if you say they exist something, you mean it cannot be that for all things it's false.
I'd happily say
either. Yeah, so the barberfish translates it for me. I understand what you are saying. Yeah, it makes sense. And so we can summarize from an intuitionistic perspective: a classical mathematician is somebody who cannot say anything positive. Yeah, they always say negative things. Yeah, only not. It's not the case. Blah. Yeah. Okay, that works to a degree, but there is still this axiom of choice, which looked very nasty in the set theory. So I thought I'd give a simpler version of it in logic using socks. Yeah. So what does the axiom of choice say? It says, if for every left sock there is a matching right sock, then there exists an assignment from left sock to right socks, which assigns to every left sock a matching right sock. Okay? Yeah? It's clear? So, I mean, it's clear. I mean, actually, in the production of socks, you produce matching socks. And that means, and okay, you have to mark them left and right, that's a bit tricky bit, but then if you should be able to assign to every left sock a right sock. Yeah. And actually my experiments with socks show that this is not the case. Yeah. I find it very difficult to find matching socks. Yeah. So I'm doubtful about this axiom, and other people are as well. And actually, this axiom is worse than excluded middle, because it doesn't work. This bubblefish, if what you say is still, it doesn't make sense to me. Yeah. So that's the axiom of choice. And actually, this is where Kronecker maybe had a point. You need it exactly to prove this well-ordering theorem. Oh, okay. Oh, finally. We come to types, right? This was the misleading title of the lecture, maybe. Yeah. So what this gentleman, Per Martin Löw, was born in 1942. And I'm quite proud of this picture. It's from Wikipedia, but I took it, actually. I also wrote the first version of the Wikipedia article on Per. So he's a Swedish logician, mathematician, philosopher. He did lots of things, thank you, probability, whatever. And I met him a number of times, and he was an interesting character, because in any talk, he would sit in the first row, and if he doesn't understand something, he would ask questions until he understands it. Yeah, he had incredible energy, very interesting person. So Per developed type theory. So it's actually called often Martin Löw type theory. As the foundation of this intuitionistic mathematics, I should say, this is a bit of a sectarian view on mathematics, to say the least. Per Martin Löw, he wanted to develop type theory, maybe in a sense like how set theory is the basic of classical mathematics, have something which is the basic of intuitionistic mathematics. And here, this question came up in your talk, right? So what's the difference between types or sets and types? You know, one difference is that we write, here is the set of natural numbers, and we write 3 as an element of the set of natural numbers. We use this element symbol. But if we have here n, which now denotes the type of natural numbers, I write 3:n to say that 3 is an element of natural numbers. That looks like, okay, this is just different symbols, right? So what is really the difference? So here is one important difference. In set, elements are sort of, actually they are first, and they are independent of the sets they belong to. They can belong, they're not very loyal. They can belong to this set, to this set, to that set. That's quite cool, they can do this. In type theory, an element always belongs to one type. So it's only element of one type. So the 3 is an element of the type of natural numbers and not anything else. So you may think this is really bad, because 3 is also in the integers and in the reals, but it's a different 3. And actually, this is even true in set theory, funnily enough, because if you have the standard definition of integers and reals, they're not the same. Yeah? So the idea that the integers would be a subset of the reals is not actually true, even in classical mathematics. But in type theory, we are more principled, because if you think of a mathematical object, you don't think of, oh, this is anything. No, you think of, like, you think about numbers, or you think about integers, also numbers, but you think about something concrete, you think about a type, and you don't talk about mathematical objects in general. Yeah? If in set theory, if you say for all natural numbers something holds, then you actually say for all mathematical objects, which happen to be natural numbers, which is a weird idea, right? I mean, I think in mathematical practice, people do usually do it in the type theoretic way. In set theory, and this is related, in set theory, because the elements are sort of free, you can say, oh, if X is an element of this set, then it's maybe also an element of this set. But it doesn't make sense in type theory, because every element is exactly element of one type. So you cannot, this element relation doesn't really make sense. And we say this, that in set theory, membership is a proposition, is something you can talk about. in type theory, it's what's called a judgment. It's a static thing. It's part of your text. Whether your text makes sense or not, is there you need the typing relation, but you're not talking about it within your theory. And I had this, maybe it helps for computer scientists or for programmers, the relation between type theory and set theory is a bit like a language, okay, Haskell, a language which has static types, to Python, a language which has dynamic types. So that's very similar. I mean, set theory is sort of done, it's like Python, whereas type theory is a static type language. Like, okay, if you use C, then you can play all sorts of tricks, but you have to declare the types of your object and your variable in the beginning. So that's called static typing. So type theory is using static typing, where set theory uses sort of dynamic typing. It's also the case in a language like Python, you have a function which tests whether a certain object is an element of a type, whereas in type theory that doesn't really make sense because it's part of the consistency of your text whether the types match. Okay, let me give, like, to be a bit more concrete, how do things actually look like a bit more concretely? So, for example, let's talk about functions, yeah? So if you talk about this function on natural numbers, which just adds 2, f of x is 2 plus x is a function which always adds 2. So if you feed it 3, then the result is 5. I shouldn't say what I just said, because that comes to the next slide. How do we understand functions in set theory? It's a set of pairs. So 0 is paired with 0 because... No, it's paired with 2. Oh, shit, I changed this example, but I didn't change the next. So that's a bug in the slides. It should be 0 and 2, 1 and 3. 2 and 4 is incidentally right, and 3 and 5, yeah? Okay, I knew I had some bug in my slide somewhere. I changed the function for good reasons, but anyway, yeah, I didn't. So it's a set of pairs that's for any element in the domain. There's exactly one element in the codomain, such that the pair is in the set. And you have to know how to make pairs. But we do know this, and it's a little hack as well in set theory how to make pairs, ordered pairs. But okay. And functions in set theory don't need to be computable. Yeah. So anything goes. So there can be a function which for every program assigns true if the program holds and false if it doesn't stop. And we know we cannot compute this, but it's a function in the set, in the sense of set theory. In type theory, functions are actually primitive concepts. You may think it's a bit of a cop-out. So primitive. Okay, well, what is the idea? The idea of a function is a black box. Sorry, it's gray, but it's a thing from black box. You put a 3 in, and then something happens, and then 5 comes out. Yeah? And you're not allowed to look into the box, but there's some mechanism in the box. That's the idea. So actually, you can make this precise. You can write down the laws of functions. And this is called the laws of lambda calculus. So for example, if I have f of x is 2 plus x, then f of 3 is the same as 2 plus 3. I just replace this x by the argument, yeah? And that's called the beta law. And that's one of the basic laws of function. Actually, it's the only one you really need. So every function is computable because, yeah, otherwise, how do you make this little box, right? And I say always, this is a bad name in classical mathematics. A function which doesn't function shouldn't be called a function, right? Function is something which works, yeah? And also, I said so functions are primitive, but for example, in classical logic, relations are sort of part of the setup of the predicate logic. But in type theory, a relation between A and B is just the function given an A and a B returns a proposition. So there is a bit of a trade-off. Yeah, something are primitive, others are not, which are slightly different between set theory and type theory. So here is a very important principle in type theory, is this idea of propositions as types. So, I mean, I tried to explain, maybe I didn't do a good job, but I tried to explain what's the idea that Brouwer rejected this idea of excluded middle which basically says to assign a truth value, either true or false, to every statement. And because there are some statements in, about things in our mind which we don't know whether they're true or false, this is maybe not a good idea. But we can do better. Instead of assigning true or false, we assign to every proposition a type of objects which are evidence for it. So if I say a proposition, I also tell you what you need to do, what you need to construct to convince me of this proposition. So the idea is for every proposition, we assign a type of evidence that we believe into this proposition. And so for example, this here, if P then Q, which is written like this, P implies Q, can be translated in the type of functions from evidence of P to evidence of Q, which is written like this. So if you want to convince me that if P then Q, then you have to give me a machine, a box, I put in some evidence for P, it makes some noise, and out comes evidence for Q. And if you can do this, you have convinced me that if P, then Q. That's the explanation of implication. And it works actually not just for implication, it works for all of predicate logic, using maybe more advanced type theoretic constructions. And this logic is intuitionistic. So in particular, you cannot prove P or not P, because that would require that you can sort of decide a proposition without looking at it, which is tricky. I mean, you can say whether a proposition is true or false without even looking at it. There's just a bit of magic involved from this point of view. Okay. But here is an important aspect of type theory, which maybe has been not so much emphasized, but this is maybe more interesting for mathematicians for whom intuitionism is just a weird sect and I don't know, yeah. But even there's another aspect of type theory. In the sense that type theory is a more disciplined approach to mathematics. And this has some consequences. So for example, in set theory we saw, we have these different encodings of natural numbers, but we can actually distinguish them. And that sort of means we can observe implementation details, which is something in computer science we know is a bad idea. So in type theory, we can also define natural numbers in different ways. So for example, one way is alla Piano, which is an Italian mathematician, and he said, okay, natural numbers are just constructed from zero and successor. So successor is the next number. So to write three, we write successor of successor of successor of zero. And these are all the ways to construct natural numbers. Yeah, instead of having like lots of digits, he just says zero and next number. But more realistic in computer science is to use binary numbers, sequences of zero and one, which have, okay, we have to get rid of the leading zeros. So these are two different definitions of the natural numbers. And here comes the surprising thing. In type theory, we cannot differentiate between these two types. That sounds a bit weird. What does it mean? We cannot define any observation which distinguishes these two types, which is true for one and not for the other. This is maybe people think, what? I can see they're different. You can see it from outside, right? But if you work in type theory, and I give you a type, yeah, which is also sort of a black box, yeah. And then I said, can you write a statement about this type which distinguishes these two? And you can't. And I think, oh yeah, I cannot distinguish any type, but that's not true. You can distinguish, for example, the Booleans, the two-element type, from the natural numbers. You just write the statement has exactly two elements. That's true for the Boolean and it's false for the natural numbers. Yeah? And this principle goes further if you say, okay, but because you're only talking about types, that's a bit Spartan. Let's say a type with some other structure, like a group. Yeah? But actually, here, if you do these two groups, the one with the piano numbers and binary numbers, they're still, you cannot prove anything which differentiates them because all the properties you can define are what we call structural properties. They're properties about the numbers, and we cannot look at the encoding. Okay. type theory, we move on to geometry. So what has type theory now to do with geometry? I think this is one of the fascinating things when you do sort of mathematics, sort of mathematics, yeah, so not real mathematics. Then you encounter that there is a surprising sort of reusability of ideas, and this is something here, geometry. And okay, that's a bit, I have to say, a heavy heart showing the slides, because I knew both of these people, and they left us far before their time, which is sad. And I knew Vladimir, but Martin was actually a very close friend of mine, so we lived together in Edinburgh and did PhD together. So that's a very sad story that he is not with us anymore. But I want to tell a more sort of maybe cheerful story, which involves these two. And I said history is story, so I tell you a story, okay? And here is how it starts, for me at least. So in 2010, Vladimir wrote an email to the Koch mailing list. Koch is a proof tool which I actually used in teaching. Here we are. It's a tool where you can express proofs and it checks them, and actually it's based on type theory. And he wrote a draft paper about the homotopy lambda calculus. I said, what? What is this? I mean, I had to look at it and thought, this doesn't make sense to me. So I thought, this must be some crackpot, this Vovotsky. So I typed Vovotsky into Google, and turns out he is a field medalist. Okay, that doesn't really mean that he's not a crackpot, but he is a... He's a crackpot with some sort of credence, let's say. So I thought, okay. So now my next question was, what the hell is homotopy theory? Yeah. So what do you do? What do you do if you want to know what is homotopy theory? You type into Google, right? And then you get to Wikipedia and you say, oh, it has to do with like geometric things. Oi. Yeah, like the path on a sphere, the group of the paths on a sphere is different than the group of paths on a torus. Oh. And two things which have the same sort of path, group, whatever this is, they are actually homotopically equivalent. Well, how do you say homophobically equivalent or whatever? So they're sort of equivalent. And that's got, okay. What has this got to do with type theory? So Vovotsky's idea, which sounds very weird, is to say, oh, we can interpret types as these geometric objects in arbitrary dimensions, higher dimensions, so not just enough as 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. Yeah. Okay, I didn't really understand this at the time. So I sent a reply to Vovotsky saying, to Vladimir, and saying, okay, I don't know what you say, that the groups reminds me on something my friend Martin has done a while ago, or Martin and Thomas Streicher actually, about the groupoid interpretation of type theory. And then Vovotsky sent the reply, yeah, exactly, only I'm doing infinity groupoids. Wow, infinity groupoids, whatever they are. They are already a bit tricky, but infinity groupoids, oi, okay? So let me tell you a bit more of the story. When I was doing my PhD in Edinburgh, living with Martin, we asked this question, I asked this question actually, can we actually show that there is at most one proof of inequality? That sounds like a very weird question, but let me explain this. So for example, I mentioned this proposition as types. To every proposition, we associate type of evidence. So for example, the proposition that 3 equals 3, a very boring proposition, has one proof, which is called Raffel. But it's the only proof. And that's true in general. There's no proof that 2 equals 3. Okay. So you see, you either have exactly one proof or you have no proof, but you never ever have two. And this is something we can show that there cannot be more than one proof, but in type theory, we cannot show this. or at least that was tricky. When I was a PhD student, I asked some of my colleagues, my friend, other PhD students, like, well, all the type theory, like, can you prove this? I said, sure, this principle of equality elimination, which Martin Löf introduced, we can prove this because it says, if you want to prove something about all equality proofs is enough, you prove it for reflexivity, and hence that should be doing the job. And then they say, yeah, but do it in the system. I said, oh, shit, doesn't work. I'm not too stupid. So people tried, and nobody succeeded. So how can we show that it's impossible? How can we show something is impossible? And there's standards of method in mathematics or in logic. You give an interpretation for which you see it's not satisfied. You give a new interpretation of all your symbols, but you see that for this interpretation, this principle doesn't hold. And that was this Grubu-Eat model. So Martin came up with this idea: we can interpret types as Grubu-Eats. Now, I'm not going to tell you in detail. It's not really difficult, not too difficult. But a Grubu-Eat, there are two concepts in mathematics. One is equivalence relations, like having the same size. Two people having the same size is an equivalence relation. And groups, they're sort of integers together with addition and minus. And if you just look at the properties which this structure have, that's a group. And if you put both together, in a way which I don't explain today, you get a Grubu-Eat. And that's what Martin did. And he showed that this interpretation satisfies all the laws of Martin Löf's type theory, including this sort of elimination principle and so on. But there are Grubu-Eats which have more than one element. So for example, the integers are also Grubu-Eats. They're a group, but they're a Grubu-Eat. And so hence, it's impossible that we can prove uniqueness. So it was quite, in a way, a very clever idea. I mean, I think it's very clever because I also tried to prove this. I'm not having the idea about Grubu-Eat. I also tried to prove, I did prove some stuff, but I wasn't able to prove this, but Martin came up with this. Now, if you look at it, it's a very obvious idea, but at the time it wasn't obvious for us. But let me go a bit forth and back and forth. So what Vovotsky proposed, his theory, his new type theory, had an interesting principle, which is called the univalence principle. It's some kind of axiom, but I call it principle. And that's a weird sentence here. It shows that equality of types is equivalent to equivalence. It sounds like, what is going on? It sounds like a tautology. What does it mean? So, for example, if you view 3, now not as a number, but as a type, 3 elements, 0, 1, 2, for example, then there are 3 factorial, there are 6 ways to show that 3 is equal to 3. Just think of the shepherds, right? If they have 2 shepherds, each of them has 3 sheep. How many ways are there that they can show that they have the same number of sheep, right? So you fix the sequence of one of the sheep, and how can you pair that? You pair the first sheep, you have 3 possibilities. For the second sheep, you have 2, and the last one has to go to the last sheep, right? So there are 6 ways to show that 3 is equal to 3 if 3 is a 3-element set. And that is basically the content of this univalence axiom, that the way to prove that 2 types are equal is the same as the number of assignments the shepherds can do. Okay? And the interesting thing is that we can now show in the theory that the piano numbers and the binary numbers are equal. Yeah? Now, okay, back to my story. Many years earlier, so when Martin came up with this proof, I said, okay, we now know we need to add a principle that all equality proofs are unique, all equality proofs are equal. So that's an extra principle for type theory we added, and then we are fine. And Martin said, yeah, maybe, but there are some interesting principles that hold in the Grubu-Eat model. There are principles which you may be not expecting. And here's one of them. You can interpret equality of types as isomorphism, that is exactly univalence. But, okay, it's a bit of a special case of univalence. But this was basically that he already suggested this very important idea. But when I heard it, I said, oh, this is very exotic. I mean, who would do something like this, you know? And anyway, we then discussed, if we do it, then groupoids are not enough. We really should infinity groupoids, and these are, come on. How do you do infinity groupoids? We looked at it and like, nah, forget it. But the point was that Vovotsky, because he did algebraic topology, and they do omega groupoid before breakfast, basically. It's just normal thing you do, yeah? I mean, as you go, whatever, you go to the toilet, you do a bit of an omega groupoid. Yeah? That's completely normal for these people. So for him, infinity groupoids were nothing surprising. So he then suggested an interpretation of type theory which uses infinity groupoids, and this gives rise to what we now call homotopy type theory. And there's a book about it, which was written at a special year at this place. This was the place where Vladimir was professor, the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. And here are the people. I mean, here you see Vladimir. Here it's me and all these, some other people involved, some famous mathematicians. So some group, we wrote this book together. And you can download it. Oh, yeah. Okay. I haven't said anything about computers, right? Have I mentioned computers? Oh, I'm a professor for computer science now. Okay, nobody's looking. I'm going to get fired now. I say, like, you say you're a professor of computer science, you don't talk about computers. What's going on here, yeah? I apologize. Yeah, that's a very bad habit. I mean, okay. Computer, let me have one slide about computer. Type theory is a programming language and a logic and an alternative to set theory, okay? All of this, but in particular, it's a programming language. And so we can implement it. And so a number of implementations of type theory. There's Neupril, Koch, ACTA, Lean, Idris, and so on. My favorite, by the way, is ACTA, but okay, that's maybe not so... Yeah, the interesting thing is that ACTA is not the only, but one of the first systems which implements this homotopy type theory. There is also another one, a variant of Neupril, which does this. And maybe I should have talked more about this. The killer app of the system is to verify software, because software, as was pointed out earlier, is very expensive to fix, and so you would like to verify your software. And companies are now starting to do this, especially for critical systems. I mean, companies using Koch to verify some protocols which are critical for their business. So that's already happening and maybe expanding. Okay, what else do I want to say? Oh, yeah. I'm almost finished. Don't worry. Yeah, I have a take-home message. It's just one slide. It's a new Archimedean principle. Yeah. So you give me the right language and we can solve any problem. Right? So it's important to talk in the right language, and then you avoid lots of complications. Right language may be different from one case to another. And there's an interesting sort of idea what we can do with HOT. Yeah? We had this geometric intuition about HOT, but we can go further and view types not just as topological spaces, but maybe smooth manifolds, and so on. And we can identify what principles we need to add to type theory to make this valid. And this way, we have a very, very abstract way to do quite complex constructions. Actually, they are what's called infinitely dimensional category theory, which all of a sudden becomes very easy. Yeah? Oh, not very easy, it's maybe overstatement, but it becomes much easier than before. So type theory is in my mind, for many applications, a better language than set theory, which to me feels a bit like an assembly language, like a low-level language. So in computer science, we know that high-level languages give us lots of leverage. And if you want to, and this is, I mean, okay, it's important for mathematics, but it is very important for computer science, because I think we will more and more be under pressure to give guarantees what our systems are doing. And when we want to construct these guarantees, there's a high complexity, lots of work involved. So you really need to have ability to reuse your code, reusability of code. And reusability essentially relies on having these layers. Okay, I'm almost finished, but I have some advertisements, yeah? Because, I mean, you know, as a professor, you don't really have such a good salary, so I have to do some commercials. So here are my commercials. First one is this book here just come out, and it contains a chapter written by me about naive types. It's called Naive Type Theory, which is closely related to the content of this lecture, but maybe goes a bit deeper. And you can actually download it from, not the book, but my chapter, you can download from my webpage. Next, if there are any students here, here is a module which is called COMP4074. It's a 20-credit module, and I'm still looking for students signing up for it because, otherwise, if it gets too small, then these university people may just disappear it. Yeah, it's a very cool module. Yeah, and I have written some advertisement for it here. Really good lecturer, very enthusiastic, jokes, humor, everything's there. Yeah, very enjoyable. Yeah, good average. Yeah, so come on. Yeah, go for it. Yeah, no fails, by the way. Yeah. Okay, my last ad is this book. So, you know, I compared set theory with Python, yeah? And we actually doing a course here on Python. I wanted to keep my course on type theory, but my boss said, no, you have to continue doing Python, thank you very much. But at least we wrote a book about it, yeah? It's a bit of a different book because it's, the idea is to explain things mainly by example and not so much by sort of definitions and by live coding and whatever. So, okay, that's all. That's all my ads. Thank you.
Thanks very much for a great inaugural lecture. A few things I'd like to just say, comparing it with other inaugurals that I've seen across the faculty. One of the things that was very different, I've never seen so many adverts at the end of the I don't think I've ever seen an advert. Particularly not to get more students on the course. But one of the things that's often the common theme in all inaugurals is that science and academia is actually a team effort. And actually, one of the most enjoyable things in our careers are the networks that we form.
Sure.
I think that came across very, very nicely in your presentation this evening, that really what we do is all done as a team, and those personal contacts are some of the most enjoyable that we can make. So I thought that was really, really nice. So I think we'd now like to invite everyone downstairs, is it, again?
Yeah, I think so.
A few drinks. We don't do questions at inaugurals, by the way of introduction, so you can relax now, you're all finished for the evening, and we'll all head downstairs. So thank you very much, everybody. Thank you to our speaker. Let's give him one more round of applause. And then